My name is Cindy. I'm an alcoholic. There's quite a bit of. There seems to be more attention to the resentment inventory than the other two, and I found the fear inventory was really powerful for me. Fear just paralyzed me my whole life. It prevented me from doing things that I wanted to do and caused me to do things that I didn't want to do. And you know, when Dickie was talking about the fear inventory, and you know, there's a prayer we ask for God to remove them, and then the promise we commence to outgrow them, and I found that to be so true, and it's almost immediate. When you say the third step prayer, you know, you're in a state of grace until the end of the seventh step. And when I started writing, I felt relief right away. I had fears, mostly surrounding my kids, I think, that I couldn't even say out loud. I was afraid to say my fears. But once I started writing them, and it's got a grip on you, and I felt better, and it's been a huge relief, and it's been some time since I did that, but and it's all about a misconception that I can keep myself safe or them safe, or if you know, whenever I am fearful, God is not there. God is not there. I've left him out. But it was really powerful, and so worth it. Thanks.
Let me just talk about fear real quick for a moment and talk about something that I didn't touch on. And then we can perhaps take another person or two and close up here. It's been my experience that I talked about fear was the old moccasin that's very comfortable. It was the default way of doing business. And I would put that moccasin on rather than deal with the consequences of success. So as I began to have some success in sobriety and have a little bit of success in life, fear became so overwhelming that the reality of losing whatever it was that I was going to lose was easier to deal with than the fear. It's easier to deal with than the fear. So I would lose the job so that I no longer had to be afraid of losing the job. Okay? And this was a pattern that followed me all the way through my life. And I used to talk about it as being a self-destructive streak that ran down my back that was as wide as a car. But in truth, it was just that fear, it was so uncomfortable that I would rather deal with the consequences. So I would make the consequences come true. I would make the consequences come true. Anybody else like to share before we close out here? Rich?
Hi, my name is Rich, and I am an alcoholic. I have also been through the steps a few times and been able to share with some wonderful gentlemen in this room, actually, who have heard some of my story. For me, it takes practice, and when I went through it the first time, it allowed me to really let go a lot of the past. The second time, I kind of got to really dig deeper into myself and really kind of start up pulling up some of those roots of the fear and the anger, which for me is a big problem as well. Obviously, the fear is too. And then even these last couple times, it gets shorter. The 330 pages shrink, you know, then it's about 100 pages and then maybe 10 or 20. But for me, it's getting through the fear and living day to day, and that takes practice. And that's why, for me at least, it's not just a one-time thing. So, thanks.
It's 3:27, and we've been at this a little while. It's time for a pee break and a smoke break. And we'll reconvene in the meeting room in 20 minutes or so. Does that sound okay? Thanks, everybody. It's time. last year when I was sitting down here over here and Jerry was up here in this chair. And Jerry turned around and asked me a question. And I was sound asleep. And I mentioned that just to share with you that we let go of our secular life, so to speak, when we come up here. And we get involved in this, and the Spirit awakens. And we're talking about matters of great depth and weight, just great depth and weight. And it's okay if you're tired. It's okay if you're drained. It's okay, and Dick and I won't be offended if you leave. I've sat there a lot, and tried to absorb everything I could when I sat on that side of this chair. I wanted to talk just a little bit about the experience. As we've shared, this is all God-driven. This is all driven by the Spirit. It's all driven by pain, by the Spirit saying to you that, gee, something's wrong. Gee, something's got to change. And you know, for so many of us, that was out there, and what had to change was out there for so long. And now we come to realize And our sponsor and his process and God has shared with us that what needs to change is in here. What needs to change is in here. And if I've learned nothing else over the years, I've learned that there are as many experiences with the process of recovery in Alcoholics Anonymous as there are members of Alcoholics Anonymous. And as I go over there and I wander around looking at Jane's CDs over there, and I look at all the wonderful weekends and all the wonderful recordings that have been made and all the awesome people in Alcoholics Anonymous that have shared their experience on some weekends. And it reinforces the fact that there are just a lot of people out there talking about what it is to do, what it is we need to do, and how to do it. And ultimately, the experience that we're going to have with this work and the experience we're going to have in our fourth step is your experience. He shared with me that I've been sharing his story for 2 days, and I've been sharing his experience. And I asked him why it is that, you know, he let me have his experience. And the truth is, his experience and my experience are very similar. And you're going to have your experience. And there is absolutely no right and wrong involved in the fourth step of Alcoholics Anonymous. You cannot do this wrong. There's only two things that you can do that are a problem. You cannot start one, and you cannot finish it. That's it. Everything in between is okay. Everything in between is okay. More will be revealed. You know, Bob talked about writing at the top of the page a certain sentence. What I wrote at the top of the page was, God, please reveal to me that which you would have me know. Many people write the third step prayer at the top of their page. Anything's okay. Anything to bring our attention to the fact that this is a God thing. This is a God thing. For the Al-Anons in the room, just make sure that you don't put your alcoholic at the top of the page. I'll probably pay for that comment. But I couldn't resist anyway. This brings us to the fifth step in the program of recovery of Alcoholics Anonymous. We needed to share our inventory and to share our story with God and another alcoholic. And on that note, I'm going to punt here and give the microphone to Dick. And have him talk a little bit about his experience.
When I think about the fifth step, you know, I was thinking about it a little bit. It really comes from two places. It comes from a sponsee and a sponsor standpoint or experience. I'll give you my experience first, and I think I learned from one of the best. We talked about the fourth step, and a lot of people would put numbers to how many resentments they had or whatever. I'm not going to do that, because in doing that, I might take away your experience. I may make you think that in order to have this thing be successful or to have it work, that you've got to write a certain number of inventories, items. Or I may make you think that because you had more than I did, that mine isn't as good or as effective. We have to really be careful, because one of the things that Jerry taught me was that I can sap the spirit in an instant. I can take people's spirit away from them by trying to have their experience form. And he never did that to me. I know I'm not as good at it as he is. Jerry, you know, maybe he's upstairs, his ears are buzzing right now, but he would give you nothing in the inventory process. He was taught by Don that in order to have an effective experience, you needed to let the person go wherever they went. So, you know, Malcolm, I didn't know it today when Malcolm was talking, but Malcolm never did a sex inventory on his first shot. I did three pretty probably ineffective inventory attempts during that first inventory time. I started writing my inventory in November of 1993, and I got to February. And what would happen is I would write a resentment, usually on Sunday afternoons. I would go up in the parking lot at Waters in Milford. It's right on 495, and it was winter, so I'd sit there with the heat on. At home was way too chaotic. I needed to get somewhere where I could calm down and think, because my mind was so muddled and so racing and whatnot. And I managed to get one inventory item down, and I'd get in severe pain, and I'd either call him or show up at his house. And I did that stop and start. He would put me back on the track. I'd go and not do anything. Then, you know, I'd start to feel the pressure because there were other guys there, and I'd write another inventory item. And I'd get screwed up, and he'd put me back on the track. And we played that dance for 3 months. At the end of the 3 months, I lost my job. I told you that. That was one of two jobs that I lost in my career. So I'm 43, and I have no job. And I called him up to whine and moan about it. And he just said to me, Dickie, he said, it'll be all right. Don't worry about it. I had another resentment to write at that. How could you not feel pity and feel for me? I'm so wounded. I have no job. I had 9 months severance. That wasn't so bad, was it? So he did suggest, and that's all he ever did was suggest. He has this way of very subtly putting a suggestion in your mind, and he said to me, you know, it probably would be a good idea. You'd be a more effective future employee, and you'd probably be more effective in the inventory process if you finish that inventory. So that was in mid-February. I was trying to put a job search together. I had never done that before. But I managed to get the inventory done in 6 weeks. And so on a Saturday morning, I went over to his house at about 8 o'clock. And he heard my inventory. And in the fifth step for me, there was no big reveal. There was no lightning bolt. There was no... It was really pretty much of a letdown. I just read through it. He nodded and he listened and he made a few comments here and there, and that was pretty much it. And I left there thinking to myself, this isn't going to work. This is just another example of something that I've tried, and, you know, it hasn't turned out the way I thought. And you know the rest of the story, you know. Things started to change. So like Malcolm says, that proves to me that, you know, first of all, I'm not doing anything. And really, you know, it's not about how well crafted the inventory is or how well formatted it is. You know, anybody that knows me knows that I'm pretty anal retentive. Just look at my spreadsheets out there at the registration table. So, you know, all the lines had to be going a certain way, and that's the way it was for me. But I didn't have a lot of content. I didn't have a lot of content, and I didn't have a great amount of items, and it worked anyways. And like we talked about, you know, it was the first attempt. You know, it was the first of many inventories that I wrote. So, you know, we're going to be writing inventory, hopefully, for a long time. So, you know, making a big deal of the first one is understandable, but by the same token, it's not such a big deal. So now from the sponsor's perspective, I said a little bit about it. We really have to be careful about, you know, about leading people, when we're hearing inventory, leading people into places that they're not concluding on their own. Because like I said, I can rob them of their spirit. If we really look at God doing this whole thing, then how it really begins to look is we're going to see what we're supposed to see, when we're supposed to see it, and we're going to have that experience like we talked about a little bit before. And then from there, we're going to go on. We're going to go out onto the test track with that new information and with God's help and with God relieving that, hopefully, that character defect if we found it. And then we're gonna go try it on in life, and we're gonna screw it up, guaranteed. Some of my most insane behavior came after I did my fourth and fifth step. Absolutely insane, and it became clear to me at the time, you know, that I was I really learned how really insane I was by about. 1997, 1998, a lot of stuff had happened in my family life. It was chaotic, it was turmoil, and you know, a lot of life happens to us. And yet something happened and I turned a corner. I was with Jerry. We were up at Lake Winnipesaukee, and we went for a drive. He wanted to find some slippers, some moccasins. So, you know, we had to go to every moccasin store in New Hampshire. And when we were getting back near where we were going, and I looked at him and I said, you know, this is really no big deal, is it? It was like a revelation to me. All of a sudden, all the stuff that I had been through, it just became clear to me that you know, it just really, this life that we lead, this spiritual life, this journey that we're on, is really no big deal. See, we start out in this whole thing, you know, absorbed in self. And even when we're up in the inventory, we're still packed full of self. And then God starts to take that away if we finish and we begin to become less about us. And hopefully we begin to, you know, we begin to do some other things. We start working with people, and we make our amends, and we're going to talk about that tonight and tomorrow. But we begin to get that sense of ease and comfort that I talked about. That begins to become about us, and it begins to replace that calamity and that lack of proportion and all those things we talk about. And things begin to really start to settle down. And if that, and if you've done this work and that isn't happening, then that's something we can talk about as we go along. Why is that? Why have I not settled down? What's going on? You know, I love to talk about that. I do. Because there's pretty clear reasons for it, which we'll talk about as we go along tonight and tomorrow. But that was my experience. In the face of utter calamity in my life, I began to become okay. And then I went on to, another job loss. Like I said, heart attack. I had a heart attack when I was 47. That was in 2000. You know, drug addicted son. Loss of another job. We're going to have all these things. Malcolm described it the best that I've heard. You know, life is going to keep coming at us. And that's why we need to have this. And that's why we're blessed to have this. So from a fifth step perspective, being a sponsor, it's really incumbent on us to let people have their own experiences, to let them share what they know at the time and not try to give them the conclusion of what that looks like. Just to let them have their own experiences. Otherwise, it's just our ego.
My experiences surrounding what I found out about myself didn't necessarily come to me in a blaze of glory. There is no question that I discovered in my resentment inventory just how selfish, just how self-centered, just how dishonest, and just how fearful I was. I was not particularly dishonest in a cash register sense, but I was incredibly dishonest in a intellectual sense. I could convince myself that this room was painted green, and I could win the argument between you and me over why this room was green. And I could believe it to the nth of my soul. It was kind of a reflection of being the 500-pound gorilla, and I'm sure everybody's heard the 500-pound gorilla story. Everybody who's a big book enthusiast uses the 500-pound gorilla from time to time. And I approached life like the 500-pound gorilla running down the path. And life would put a stone wall or a brick wall across the path. And I would be the 500-pound gorilla that ran into the brick wall. And like a good alcoholic and somebody who has the capacity to rationalize anything in the world, I would go back up the path and start to run down the path again until I got a little bigger head of steam. And I would hit the wall harder. And I would do it again. And I would hit the wall harder. And I never understood that God put a little bench beside the wall. And that my job when I hit the wall was to sit down on the bench and to wait until God showed me whether I needed to take a left or a right. Because I would come down that path over and over again, and I would pound that wall until I stood on the other side of the wall in a pile of rubble. And that was the story of my life. And I had discovered this in my fourth step. And I don't want to have your experience for you and what you discover. You may discover it at the time you do your writing, and you may discover it as you work with others and as you move on down this path. And you may discover some things at the time that you share your fifth step, and so on and so forth. I discovered in fear inventory later on, I discovered that I made it all up. Which is an experience that my friend Bill had as well. That, I looked at my fear, and all of my fears were imaginary. Made them all up. You know? What did God give us the instinct of fear for? But to protect us from imminent harm. It's not to protect us from something that hasn't happened yet, that only might happen, that's maybe the 999th possibility out of 1,000. God didn't give us fear to protect us from that. So our instincts were all awry. Our instincts were all awry. I discovered most of this in the process of listening to other fifth steps and in the process of sharing this experience from the front of a room and across the table from another alcoholic reading the book with him. You know, as Dick said, my experience of doing my fifth step was not this earth-shattering, lightning come down from the sky experience. I had done a fifth step as part of an AWOL earlier, maybe when I was 8.5, 9 years sober, when I was medicated. And I had shared with my sponsor at the time, Richard Fielder, my life story. And I shared with him the 223 questions out of the Hazelton Guide. And this was painful. This was very painful to read all this inventory now. So I had the experience of telling somebody else my story. So by the time I worked with Jerry and was involved in this little group, I didn't have anything that I couldn't tell you. I wasn't afraid of any. I didn't have any secrets. You know, a couple little teeny things I was going to take to the grave with me, which I found out much later on, were no big deal. And I did share them with Jerry in my second fifth step. That second fifth step was a Sunday afternoon. I brought my inventory to Jerry's house. I went down in the basement and we sat in a couple of chairs with a little table between us. And I shared that inventory with him. He didn't have a lot of time and I didn't have a lot of time. And I hightailed it out of there. And my experience, as I said, wasn't earth-shattering. Since in all the work that I've done with others, in doing their inventory work, I generally spend a lot of time with somebody. I'll see them every week. I'll see their inventory work as it comes along. We'll talk about it. I probably know them pretty well by the time we get to the end of this. And they've shared with me their resentments, and we've talked about their resentments and their fears as we've gone through this inventory. And a great deal of their fifth step is done by the time we sit down and do their fifth step. So what I try to do when I sit with somebody is review the work and the writing that they've done again, say a prayer with them, have them share with me once again their life story, what I don't know, what they feel they need to share, so I know and God knows what it is that we need to know. And we move on down the highway. And I've had infinitely more powerful experiences listening to you than listening to me. Maybe if we move this on to Dick, and maybe he's got the book open. Maybe you can share a little more.
I agree. The joy in working with other people has been certainly overrides the fifth step process for me. It's been great. You guys have given me far more than I could ever give you, and that sounds cliche, but it's really true. And anybody that's worked with anybody, I think, can relate to that. Before we move on, anybody have any questions, fifth step questions or comments? Got a little time here. Mary?
Hi, everybody. I'm Mary. I'm an alcoholic. I had a question from a sponsor standpoint on the fifth step, because you said to allow them to have their own experience, which I agree with. But my question is, when they come to you with your fourth step, their fourth step, and they are still the victim, how do you approach that? You know, so that's my question.
Oh, boy. Let me give the mic back to Dick quick. If an individual that comes to me with their fifth step, and I'm not familiar enough with them, and I haven't spent enough time with them to know that there might be some boulders in the way of them having an experience, then I may not have done my job as a sponsor. And you know, this goes to the heart of letting them have their own experience. And what Mary asked, we may try to just plant a couple of thoughts in the air and let them go with those thoughts. It's a tough one because it falls into the category of I'm an alcoholic, I'm an alcoholic and I'm an alcoholic, but there's an excuse. And it can be a huge boulder to recovery. And the individual may not be ready to overcome that boulder. And God may not have touched them in a way, in a manner that they can see, you know, that they're responsible for the fact that they're a victim.
I would agree. I think that, you know, I use my grand sponsor and my sponsor as examples of that. And I, you know, that's what they've told me, because I've asked the same question. They would let them have their experience, you know. Like, maybe we can plant a thought. If you remember, for those of you that weren't here last year, we got into some conversation about that fourth column, and we were talking about, you know, what happens to people that have had horrific things happen to them, and maybe violent crimes or some sort of sexual, issue or whatever. And somebody asked that question, you know, what do we do with that as sponsors? And you know, how does that look? And one of the ways Jerry answered that, if you remember last year, was we try to help them see what they did with that experience, not what they did to cause that experience. In other words, after the fact, if I'm looking over in the fourth column about, you know, what was my part? Maybe my part was that I hung on to that and I became that victim. That kind of made me think of that, Mary, a little bit, because maybe that's in somebody's mind about the fourth column or whatever. You know, it relates to the sponsor or sponsee experience. And maybe they do need a little help to see that. But we can't conclude for them. That's what I believe. We can't. Having their experience means we lead them to the answer ultimately, or give them the answer. And we wouldn't be doing them a service at all, because then we rob them of that experience, and they don't get to see that. If you think about for those of you that have had a fifth step experience, think of some, you know, spiritual experience that you've had during that, where, you know, all of a sudden, bink, something comes completely clear to you. You know, if somebody gave you that, what would happen? You know, you might not have that opportunity to have that meaningful spiritual awakening, if you will, around that particular circumstance. So we always try our best to let people have their own experience. Any others? Any other comments about fifth steps? Danny?
Around my experience with the around people having you know, I don't know how to put it anyways. I just go right to the point. But if someone comes to me and they're having a problem with still being a victim, we'll use the same exact example. I may ask them a question or two that and if God's in the room with us and everything's working the way it's supposed to, they'll come to the conclusion. That's pretty much the experience I've had with it, is that when I, you know, because I was one of those people that I knew that this one here is the one, and this is why Jerry's not going to be able to show me that this was my fault, because I was so greatly wrong. You know what I mean? And what would happen is he would ask me a simple question, and I would, oh, shoot, the light would come on. You know what I mean? And that's what happens in this process, is the light comes on. And we get to see the light come on in people's eyes, and we get to have their experience. You know, and my light would come on over and over again. You know, one of the cases was, you know, there was a situation where there was a store clerk, and Tony had went to the store to call me one of the times when I was in the bad boy spot and I was staying at my mother's and I had my daughter, and I had to bring my daughter home when Tony was home because I wasn't allowed home when, you know, I was in a bad boy spot, so I could only be there at certain times. But anyways, the guy and Tony got into it and he hit Tony with the phone. And you can imagine my reaction. I mean, it ended up in a legal case anyways. So that one there was the one that, you know, you can't, there's no way, it's not my fault. The guy hit my wife but you know what came to it was, what ended up coming out of that was that she had already taken care of the situation. And I went over there like a maniac, and what I did was make it worse. You know what I mean? And she wasn't, it wasn't even about her. You know, what it ended up being was, it was about me, because how dare you hit my, he knew who I was and he hit my woman. My woman, she had already beat him up herself. She had already hit him with the phone, and it was already taken care of. You know what I'm saying? It was already taken care of. And I just escalated the situation into a felony assault case. Do you know what I'm saying? That's what happened, because of my ego. Because how dare you hit my woman, even when she wasn't my woman. You know what I mean? And I went over there and I proceeded to make everything worse. And it was all about me. And it was all about how I was going to look, that people would perceive me as a punk because I didn't do anything about it. And in the end, I ended up being a punk because I went there and made a big scene and got arrested in front of my daughter and blase, blase, and caused all this drama. You know what I mean? And it's all about me. So just by asking me a simple question, the light came on. That it was all about me from the beginning. And it was all my selfishness and my fear of looking bad. I can't look bad in front of you. You know exactly what I'm talking about, Malcolm. I cannot look bad in front of you people. You know what I mean? So even if you didn't even know what was going on, I couldn't look bad. But so it's pretty, you know, like these guys are saying, it's pretty simple, you know. And sometimes we don't see it at that time. We may even go through the end of the whole inventory, and then you can even, like, you know, let's look at this one again. You know, have them read it again, and then, wow, they read it again, and all of a sudden, bam, there goes the answer. You know, and it's just a God thing. You know, thanks.
Thanks, Danny. Yeah, so we're gonna meet it where it is, as Danny says. You know, at the time, when the time is right to see the truth, we're going to see the truth. And so that goes, like you said, at the opposite end from trying to lead people into the truth. We just leave it alone. God will reveal to us what he would have us know at the proper time. And the rest of that is all just experience. And anybody else before we move on? Tom?
Hi, I'm Tom again. One of the things that helped me is what my sponsor gave me was for the dishonesties, gave me a list to work with, which really kind of was a little leading because he had dishonesties such as put myself in that position, others are spiritually sick, did the same thing myself, out of my control, and things like that. And some of those things help me. And so when I sponsor people and listen, usually I'm working with them during the fourth step, so by the time they're reading their fifth, that they're pretty familiar with those things, and I can kind of explain to them along the way how those things apply. Because oftentimes I found when I was doing my writing, you know, oftentimes I was, you know, people were doing bad things to me, but, you know, first time it's, you know, shame on them, and then, you know, every other time it's shame on me, and, you know, I didn't, you know, I realized that I was trusting, you know, the wrong types of people and things like that. And so with that being said, you know, I have had sponsees that I've listened to that had, you know, been one, and specifically have been molested numerous times by older men. And one thing I was very, very cautious about and very conscious of was to make sure this person wasn't re-traumatized by talking about this. And when they did this dishonesty, that, you know, as far as their selfishness, they didn't want this. I mean, there was nothing, you know, that they wanted here. And what it was really about was, you know, accepting the fact that that this was truly out of their control. Because so oftentimes when bad things happen to us, real bad things happen to us that are completely out of our control. It's very, very hard for an alcoholic to accept. And the dishonesty is we are trying to control something that really at the time was out of our control. And help them to comprehend that so that they can let that go. And just one last thing is, even for myself, there was abuse growing up that was real. But like what you said about what did I do with it, you know, I used to get dates telling my story. You know, I would tell my story so people would feel sorry for me, and, you know, it worked pretty well. So some of us could take some real things that happen and do some very sick things with it. And we really, you know, I had to really discover that that's all, you know, was part of my self-pity. Thanks.
Thanks, Tom. That's perfect. I mean, that's the real deal to what I was talking about, which is a perfect real-life example of that. And I think that's right on the money. You know, it's funny, we talk about dishonesty. To get back to my fifth step for a quick minute, you know, I had no dishonesty in my first fifth step because to me, dishonesty was, you know, was stealing something. And again, my sponsor never tried to lead me. It just didn't really come up in conversations. So my first inventory, all the way down the line, there was no dishonesty. That character defect wasn't even written. He didn't say a word. He let me have it. And believe me, it came. It came back on the next one, you know. And I thought dishonesty looked like, you know, stealing nuts and bolts at the Home Depot or something, which I did plenty of. I didn't look at that either, you know. But you know, the other dishonesty came up in time, too, and I was able to begin to, you know, to begin to see truth about that and then go back and inventory it and go back and get it. So, anyone else? I see Jerry is with us.
Yeah.
Well, it's good to see you up, at least vertical and up and about. So we're gonna move on if nobody else has anything, and we're gonna talk about steps 6 and 7. And I'm gonna read each one from the book, and we'll talk a little bit about that. Malcolm will talk a little bit about that. Step 6 and step 7 are two short paragraphs. They're on page 76 in the book. And if you think about that, why is that? You know, we're about to take all the things that we've talked about over the last 24 hours or so, all the things that we've learned in our inventory that we've told to another human being, and then basically offer them up to God. But first, they have to be objectionable. And a little story that actually involves Malcolm and Jerry and some of the people that were here at the time. Back probably, it must be 15 years ago, Malcolm's always had a gig. You know, he's always been somewhere. And where he was at this particular point in time was at the PIP shelter in Worcester. And we used to have this retreat there. And Don was alive back then. And the PIP shelter, for those of you who don't know, is basically a homeless shelter. You know, it's run by the city of Worcester. It's on Main Street, down by Chandler, down, you know, in the not-so-hot section of town.
Main South.
I was just there the other day, actually. And it's cleaned up a little bit, but it's still basically Main South. But anyways, we would have our whole retreat at the PIP shelter. And I can tell you that the PIP shelter is not the Wilson House. We had a little girl that came down that I sponsored. I'll never forget it. She had a brand new Nissan Maxima, and she had big hair, and she was dressed to the nines, and all the rings. And she pulled in. She was on this path. She really was. But she pulled in and came up and sat down at the PIP shelter and promptly broke down and broke out in tears. She couldn't believe the reality, you know, of what that situation was like. We had the meeting amongst homeless people, and it was fantastic. We had a lot of good years there. I can't remember how many, but five. Anyways, I bet I was about 3 years out from the work, the first work that I had done, and it was Sunday morning. It was about 11 o'clock. We were getting ready to wrap up and take Jerry back to the airport to get him home, and he said something to me. And, you know, we had been all through this a few times. You know, I probably read it 5 or 6 times in the book. And, see, this gets back to this idea about letting people have their own experience. This experience for me was 3 years out from when we first started. And he read this. And here's what he read. He says, if we can answer to our satisfaction, then we look at step 6. We have emphasized the willingness as being indispensable. Are we now ready to let God remove from us all the things which we have admitted are objectionable? Can he take them now? All, or can he take them all now? Everyone. If we still cling to something, we will not let go. We will ask God to help us be willing. Now, like I said, I had heard that 4 or 5 times, read it 4 or 5 times, heard it numerous times. That particular morning, the word objectionable hit me like a freight train. It just made perfect sense to me. How can we ask for to have something removed if it's not objectionable? And see, I could never have come to that if I hadn't had the experience for 3 years in between when I heard that read for the first time, and it didn't mean a whole hell of a lot of anything, to the point where he read it and it was like a freight train. Because I had 3 years of mayhem out there and craziness, and I got to see the things that I had asked to be removed the first time, but that apparently weren't objectionable enough until I could be crazier and be able to see that craziness and find it objectionable in a subsequent inventory. And see, so that's how this works. Like Don used to say, if it isn't objectionable, God isn't going to remove it. And the truth of the matter is we actually like some of our character defects. We like them. You know, you talk to a drunk that's new in the program, and, you know, the first thing he says is, I can't wait to write, and I can't wait to get rid of all this stuff. And then, you know, then all of a sudden, you know, we come to the rubber meets the road, you know. I had a guy that... He said, you know, we got to write. We got to write fast. I got to, you know, and then we get up to the writing, and it took him a year, you know. 4 weeks to get there, a year to do it. So we've got to find this objectionable. So like we talk about, Rich Fielder used to say, we're going to move the boulders out of the way. We're going to get that out of the way. But maybe if it isn't objectionable, God's going to let it linger. Barbara lingered for 14 years. Till she was objectionable, till that behavior was objectionable to me. It took a job loss for me to see that as a real objectionable issue. And once I did, it was easy as can be to get rid of it, to give it to God. I didn't have any problem at all. I was able to call Jerry up and do it, and it was done. So it's got to be objectionable. That's step 6.
We identified in our fourth step, or I identified in my fourth step, how selfishness, self-centeredness, dishonesty, and fear dominated and controlled my life, my resentments, and my fears. Any character defect I have in any behavior I have stems from those four things. So as I look at my inventory work and I look at my fourth column, I can identify the character defects that need to be removed. So am I ready, as Dick said, am I willing to have God remove my selfishness, my self-centeredness, my dishonesty, my fear? I've asked God to remove my fear. And for the most part, God remove my fear right away. I picked it back up from time to time, and it has dragged me around in my life from time to time. Most recently surrounding the job I had in August and September of this year. And once again, when I find it objectionable, when it begins to dominate my life, eventually I'll ask God to take it away. Eventually I'll inventory it. I'll ask myself why I have it. I'll ask God to take it away. Same with the selfishness, self-centeredness, and dishonesty. The intellectual dishonesty, as Dick was saying, I didn't always find it objectionable. I didn't always find it objectionable that I can rationalize some poor behavior. When it became objectionable, I became willing, and I would ask God to remove it. This is a point, and Janice talked about it, lovingly talked about being at the Fellowship of the Spirit in 2004 and having to talk about the sixth and seventh step. What she didn't share with you was it was an hour-long workshop, and Jerry was there, and all of our friends were there, and I got asked to lead that workshop and talk a half an hour about the sixth and seventh step, and Janice followed me, and Ben followed Janice. And I got up to the stage to talk about the sixth and seventh step, and I had absolutely no idea how I was going to take up a half an hour talking about the sixth and seventh step. Absolutely no idea. Because it had been presented to me, and my experience was pretty simple. You know, your character defects are selfishness, self-centeredness, dishonesty, and fear. And, you know, when we became willing, we asked God to remove these. And then we read the seven-step prayer, and that was that. But my experience, my true experience in doing this was a place where my life and my recovery took a left-hand turn. My life and my recovery took a left-hand turn. And I'm going to get the seven-step prayer and actually read it to you. What it actually says in the paragraph, in the prayer, is, "My Creator, I am now willing that you should have all of me, good and bad. I pray that you now remove from me every single defect of character which stands in the way of my usefulness to you and my fellows. Grant me strength as I go out from here to do your bidding. Amen." We have then completed step 7. So God was going to remove my character defects, the ones that stood in the way of my usefulness to him and my fellows. And something clicked somewhere along the line that this was no longer about me. It was no longer about me. I was going to go out from here and make some amends, make a list, begin to work with others. And this needed to begin to be about you. About you. So my experience with this, and it was the first time I was able to verbalize it in 2004 at this Fellowship of the Spirit, that I have a purpose now. I need to go out and set right the wrongs I've done. I need to ask God to remove the character defects that he didn't have any use for. I'm probably sitting up here on this table because my ego has driven the fact that I need so very much for you guys to approve of me. And I need so very, very much to be important to you guys. So, as Dick said, I've always had a gig. I've always had something going on. And from that New Year's Eve in 1995, from the first time I got up in front of the room at Spectrum House, and I just completed my third step, and I had absolutely no right to be reading the book to these guys. I had a gig. And every Friday night, I started to read that book to those guys. And I started to try to bring it to life as I'm desperately trying to find some recovery with Jerry and with these guys. And God has kept me engaged with all of you ever since. My sense of well-being hasn't been invested in that for a long time. Maybe for the first 5 years I did that, it was about me. It was about me. And it was about me making you have my experience. So God took that character defect, that huge amount of ego that I had, and that huge need for you to approve of me, and he put me up in front of the room. And he gave me a microphone. And he said to me and gave me the opportunity to bring this to life and to maybe try to have a little bit of impact in your life. My Creator, I am now willing that you should have all of me. I am now willing that you should have all of me. It goes back to God is everything or He is nothing. It goes back to page 3. It goes back to my third step. I've now completed the body of work, and I've now asked God for the grace to go forward. Ask God to remove my character defects. Ask God to show me the way. Show me the way. Boy, what else? It says it all. Maybe some of you could share some of your experiences with us surrounding this. We got a microphone going up there. Kevin, can we jump on the mic up back there? You know? Did I wake you up back there, Kevin? You're doing a little writing. What a great answer. You're doing a little writing. There we go.
Mike, alcoholic. I just love this process because when I did the third step prayer, I don't know that I really meant it. I was just doing it, and I said that prayer every single day for a long time. And I just kept saying it, and I thought something was going to happen by saying it. And it wasn't until I actually then took some action that things started to happen. And then when I got to my seventh step, I actually sat with that prayer for a little while, and I really reflected on it, because when I did my inventory, what I found out was that I'm a judge. And so when I look at that seventh step prayer and take it literally, and it says, I am now, you know, I'm now willing for you to have all of me, good and bad. And that means a couple of things to me. In the third step, to me, I was like, okay, I was taking a little bit of action and I was kind of surrendering. When I got to the seventh step, that's just ultimate surrender. I am now willing for you to have all of me. And then I look at that good and bad part, because you know what? I don't know, because I'm a judge. I don't know. So good and bad is absolutely everything. And that's just where I have, that's just how I have to work it in my mind. I just have to do it. So, like the third step, I take some action. I don't necessarily believe yet. Thank God. Second says come to believe, because I didn't at that point. And then when I get to that seventh step, I really was like ready. Now I really got to do something. Like now it's like, okay. I'm done. And that was just the way the process worked for me. And then I loved, and I remember sharing with my sponsor once, and I was like, why are these character defects not removed? I don't get it. What's going on here? And he said something simple. It was like, well, how do you know whether they're of use or not? I was like, yeah, you're right, right. Oh, right, I'm a judge. I don't know. I just said I was willing. Good or bad, so take all of me. So the second part of that is, which blocked me from usefulness to you and my fellows, right? So I don't know. And you know what? My peace and serenity comes from not even wanting to ask anymore. Just if they're there and they show up, I take some action about them, but I don't want to know. I don't want to know, because the minute I think I know, I'm in trouble. So, thanks.
Anybody else?
We're coming up on 10 minutes of 5 here, and we're going to serve dinner roughly 5:30. And we can move on, talk a little bit more about the sixth and seventh step, and move on to talking a little bit about the eighth and ninth step, talking about amends work. Or we can wrap it up now and pick this up at 7:30. Whatever you guys would like to do. We have any thoughts out there? Yeah. We can, yes, that's the other thing we can do. We can shove the microphone in Jerry's face and
My name is Jerry, and I am an alcoholic. I'm getting some help from Kevin. Hold on. My mother told me to never walk into a room chewing gum, and here I had some. Thank you, Kevin. Okay. I told Glenn here, I said, you know, I'm kind of reluctant to say anything at this point in time. I know Malcolm and I know Dickie so well, and I've listened to him over the years, and I think we had been together as a group no more than, oh, maybe 6 or 7 months. I don't remember when, but we went up to, where was the little town where Peter and Drew had their restaurant? Quincy. We went up to Quincy one night. Somebody had invited us as a group to come up there and go to a meeting. And I think there were 5 or 6 of us from our group. So we all went in there together, and they asked the group, each member of our little group, because we were visiting, to share something with their group. And Dick and Dana and Malcolm and trying to think who all was involved that night, Chris. But anyway, there were 5 or 6. And they began to share their experiences and their stories. And I tell you what, I was never so fascinated with listening to other guys in my entire life. I thought I knew them. We'd been together 5, 6, 7 months. And we had done a lot of this together. And they commenced to share themselves. And like I say, I either heard things I had never heard them say before, or I heard it in a way that I'd never heard it before, but I was so deeply touched, and I realized that what had accidentally happened was these guys looked at me as their sponsor, and I had raised a garden full of sponsors, and so I knew that I would always have somebody that I could talk to if I ever needed to. And we've been together now since 93 or 4, which was it, 4? It was 4, wasn't it? 93 or 94, and we've just had just an absolute wonderful, does not describe it. The journey of finding out who we are and who we are not came to life in a way that I didn't think this was possible. I had done the book before, and I knew something about the book, and I had been more or less through the book pretty thoroughly, but never in a way that we had with that initial group out here in Rhode Island. And I look back on that, and I with such fond memory, because one of the things that you'll discover if you do what we do is that you have to have somebody you can share this with. You have to have somebody you give it to. I was listening to some of you speak when they passed the mic around, and one of the things that I noticed was that there are some of you who have already discovered that you have a necessity to give this away. We've spent some time this weekend talking about this very thing. You know, it's okay to go through this process and to do what it suggests to do. But if we don't start trying to give it away as soon as it's been given freely to us, somehow we've missed the boat. We really have. See, when our surrender is so complete in step one, that the moment that the Spirit is awakened within us, it has to start trying to come out. And the only way it can come out is to talk with others. I came into AA in 1977 in January. As completely broken as a fellow could be. And he didn't know he was broken. I was in miserable, miserable place because I could not stop drinking no matter what. I had 3 children. I had every reason in the world to not drink. And yet, morning after morning after morning, I would get up and promise myself, today I'm not going to drink. And I couldn't even make it from the bedroom to the kitchen without thinking, well, I could just use one. And then one was 2. And then I would start off all over again. And then at some point, by late morning or maybe around lunchtime, it was necessary to lie down and take a nap. And I'd wake up from the nap, and then I'd need another drink to get me going. And you can see where that vicious cycle went. And I can remember so clearly the horror of knowing that I should not drink another drink. And I'd heard a little bit about AA by the time I reached the end, but all I heard from AA was that it's a program of total abstinence. And I could not conceive of never taking a drink again. I used to tell these guys that I what I wanted to do was to not take a drink, but take a drink. And there's no way to achieve that. But I was in my insanity. And in my need for just a little bit of peace of mind, in order to just get the mind to quiet down a tiny little bit, I had to have a drink. You know, I from time to time have the occasion to work with somebody who's in that spot, or I'll read a story about somebody who's caught in the throes of the addictive nature of our illness, and they just cannot quit. And I can remember that time so clearly. In fact, I don't know that I want to ever forget it. I really, truly don't. And I look at my life today, and I think, wait a minute, how can I go from January 17th, 1977, until now, and find it unnecessary to take a drink? Because back in on that last few days before I got into AA, it was absolutely necessary every day to take a drink. A lot of people talk to us alcoholics, and they say, why would you drink knowing the kind of trouble you're going to get into? And you'd like to explain to them, you'd like to shake them and say, wait a minute, I'm in trouble right now without the booze. If I can take some alcohol into my system, the trouble will begin to go away, or at least it will appear to. And you know, this is such a... this illness, and today I understand clearly that it is a deep, deep spiritual illness. I was born with this illness. I brought it with me from the time I was just a young little old kid, and I knew there was something wrong with me. I used to try to sit and ponder that. What in the world is wrong with me? I always knew there was something wrong with me. And the first time I took a drink, that immediately went away. I was suddenly had that beautiful sense of being okay. Now, that only lasted that first time, and from that first drink all the way through to the last, I was always looking for that fix, that suddenly being okay again. I never was able to find it. And so, you know, you wind up and you're 35 years old, and every morning when you awaken, and all throughout the day, and sometimes during the night, the only apparent relief is to take a drink, and then you finally reach the point where you suddenly awaken to the fact that, or gradually, it makes no difference, it becomes clear to you that this isn't a solution either. And so somebody says you might try AA, and my first thought about AA, because I knew just enough about it to know that it was a program of abstinence, and I said AA will not work for me. I still have a great deal of compassion for an active alcoholic, because they say, well, that won't work for me. And I have a pretty good understanding that they meant the same thing that I meant, which was, I'm afraid to even try because you're going to ask me to put the booze down and never pick it up again, and I cannot do that. I had tried that on a number of occasions. And if you're a real alcoholic, I would throw out the thought that there's probably no way that you can live without drinking if you don't have some other solution. And for me, that without overworking the same tired ideas, that solution had to be spiritual. Alcohol is a spirit. I consume spirits, and my spiritual malady is overcome, or at least I get temporary relief. So I come in here in January of 1977, fully convinced that I can't do what you can do. And if you run into a newcomer at a meeting and they say, well, this isn't going to work for me, listen past the words that you hear. What they're saying is, I don't think I can do what you guys do. That's what they're really saying to you. I'm afraid that I can't do what you guys do. I was 13 years sober when I first met my sponsor, and he talked about working a spiritual program, and I remember looking at him, and I was as far back in that little meeting as I could get on the back row, and he talked about we needed a spiritual program and a spiritual solution. And I watched him that night, and I thought, you know, his name is Don, and I said, Don, I thought to myself, Don, you can do spiritual programs because you're naturally spiritual, and I am not. I am as far removed from the spiritual life as anybody could be, because by the time I got here, and then again 13 years later, I was so broken that I just felt like I couldn't do. I would mix up spirituality and religion, and I hope everybody here is past that. But in those days, I wasn't past that yet, and I was 13 years sober. But I did. I was convinced that the spiritual way of life was something I couldn't do. I couldn't do it. People who are naturally spiritual can do it, but those of us who are as unclean as I am, you know, I just can't do this. And so I labored that way, and then I finally muttered something to this guy about being my sponsor, and the rest is history. And I showed up out here in 1992 and wandered around for a year looking for something to do and trying to talk to people about the book, and nobody really wanted to listen. And I understood, because I was still trying to, as Bill says in his story, I was still trying to tell them. I didn't want to share anything. I just wanted to tell them. And after a year of some of those sharp and dumb Kansas accents got knocked off, they let me go into a little meeting up in Milford, and we just had a wonderful time. Went up to Upton Spirit and down to Rhode Island, and one thing led to another, and we were all over this part of the country. And I'm hooked up with these guys, and away we went. We had a wonderful time, and I think we began to get well. And here I am these years later. And the stories that any of us in that little group could tell you are fun stories, and sometimes they're not quite so fun. But we've discovered, among other things, we all talk about spirituality. Well, we've all discovered in our little group that we also are human, and we are in our humanness right now. And we're trying to accept the fact that we are human. I'm a spiritual being, but I'm sure in a human condition. And I have to accept that that's my reality. That's my reality. And I would suggest that it's your reality, too. And, you know, I was always looking for an answer, and I did not know that what I really needed was a solution. And, again, I want to be careful not to overuse the same words that we've all heard so many times that they began losing their meaning. But I do need a solution, and AA provided that. And then finding folks like yourself that would sit here and listen. And I've been coming up here for a while, and to this day I'm still not sure why you all sit in a hot, stuffy room and listen to a guy like me. I really don't. but I will tell you this, I am exceedingly grateful. Gail knows how much you all mean to me. I've had a bit of my humanness this weekend, but as I was sitting over there in the room, I still don't feel like running a foot race. But I couldn't hardly stand to stay over there and not see you all. And whether I do anything or not after I got over here was irrelevant. The fact is, I needed to see you and I needed to spend some time with you because this is who I am, just like this is who I suspect you are. So I tell you what, we'll just have a grand time, and I can't thank Dickie and Malcolm enough for doing what they did. I look around this room, and I just have a whole room full of friends, and you're absolutely marvelous, and I thank you.
Thank you, Jerry. Thank you, Jerry. You've convinced everybody in the room that you were not an illusion. On that note, let me just take care of a little bit of housekeeping. We'll meet at 7:30 in the firehouse, and if you all could put this room back together, there is a regular AA meeting here tonight, and we'll put this room back together. We'll meet in the firehouse tonight. Hopefully Jerry will be able to join us and take a seat with up at the front and carry forward from here. Thanks, everybody. Thank you.